Internal exposure groups mean that you take, and my example is a neighborhood, okay? We take a neighborhood and we pick the exposures from within the neighborhood, or some sort of cohesive group like a plant, workers of a particular plant, you might be able to choose as an internal exposure group. And you choose some exposure that not everyone experiences. So some houses in the neighborhood might not be tested positive for radon. Some jobs at a plant might not be highly repetitive. So you can differentiate exposure and non-exposure from within that cohesive group. When you do that, you ensure that there's homogeneity between the exposed and the non-exposed groups, which is good. You want both of those groups to be homogeneous. For an external exposure group, if it's not the same plant, you would compare it to two different locations. It's not nearly as homogeneous, and then you have exposures at one plant that you don't have in another plant, for instance. The groups are still relatively homogeneous, but not as much so as if you use internal controls. You have to then work to match that external group to make sure that they're not fundamentally different in some ways, like you inadvertently choose a group that's much older than another, which could happen at some plants. Some other aspect of them is drastically different than your comparison plant that you're using for controls. So that's the distinction between internal and external. this is kind of a slide to summarize. When you are measuring either exposures or conditions, you have to ensure, and I'm repeating myself here, but I think that it's important to make the distinction. You have to be sure that there's a distinction between how you measure each one of those things. So for exposure, how are you measuring exposure? Are you measuring subjectively by questionnaires? Did you do this job? Well, it depends on what you're asking them, because most people will remember whether they've used metal lathe at a plant, and therefore whether they were forced to use the metalworking fluid that becomes airborne, people inhale it, there's a variety of conditions that you can result from it. So they're likely to remember something like that, but as we talked about in ergonomics, as we will talk about in ergonomics, those of you that are in it still, as a matter of fact, we'll talk about it tomorrow, people are very bad at remembering when they injured themselves. Which may sound odd, but think about when you had a cold. Do you remember where you were and what you were doing when you picked up the cold? Most of the time, not. Right? Unless it was some remarkable circumstance, you usually don't remember. And back pain particularly, people develop it and they have a very, very poor recall of when they develop it. And so questionnaires aren't so good under the circumstances like that. So questionnaires may or may not be appropriate, but you have to evaluate that before you get started. You might want to use physical measurements to determine exposure. That's probably better. So if we're doing something like occupational exposures to something like a chemical exposure, you can measure that. You can measure particulates. You can measure a variety of things very easily with properly calibrated industrial hygiene equipment. You can look at records. Those are not infallible, but they're a good source as well. And those are just some examples of measuring exposure. For the condition, you have to, like I said, be sure that you a priori, in other words, before you get started, you have to be sure that you define how you're going to define that condition, or determine how you're going to define that condition. So, if you are going to require a nerve conduction velocity test, for instance, require that for everyone. Or if you're going to use a simpler test, require that for everyone, be consistent with it. and you use it for everyone, whether they're exposed or non-exposed. You can use diagnoses, which is what they used it for. They used the ICD code. Have you guys ever heard of the ICD coding system?
Mm-hmm.
It's International Classification of Diseases. They used the ICD-9 codes from their physicians. The trouble is that ICD updates its coding scheme. And when they went from ICD-9 to ICD-10, it took them about 15 years to implement it, because it was like going from Dewey Decimal to Library of Congress. It was that different. It went from a strictly numerical code to an alphanumeric code. That was quite different, and they even wrote programs to convert them, because it was not at all easy to do. So diagnoses may be good, but you have that type of a problem, plus differences amongst physicians. Physicians often don't agree on diagnoses,
sure.
So that could be problematic as well. Record self-reports, and so on. It's a similar type of caveat. So you have to be certain that you are aware of the limitations of the technique that you're using to establish condition and exposure. Have a question, Prince?
No.
No?
Okay.
So this is a summary between cohort and control. Better for rare exposures, case control, better for rare conditions. Cohort, need more money, case control, don't need as much money. Cohort, you could, if you wanted to, look at several outcomes of interest. Case control, you could look at several exposures of interest, if you want to. And so they are different in what they what their forte is from one to the other. So those are some of the main considerations. Now let's talk about what we do with these data once we get them. Okay. Like I said, you're going to get tired of the 2x2 tables, because all of these that start out with today, we use a 2x2 approach. Because of the differences between case control and cohort, there's a different way to calculate your risk. Okay. For case control, we calculate what's referred to as the odds ratio. Odds ratio is A times D over B times C. For cohort studies, we calculate what's referred to as a relative risk. Relative risk is A over the marginal total for exposed, divided by C, which is divided by the marginal total for the unexposed. Okay. The odds ratio is considered an estimate. We'll talk about that in a moment. An odds ratio is considered an estimate of a relative risk, but you interpret the results exactly the same way. Okay. If it's greater than 1, it's increased risk with exposure. If it's equal to 1 or not significantly different than equal to 1, it's no risk with exposure, no risk associated with exposure. And if it's less than 1, that means exposure gives you a protection. Two cases of instance where exposure gives you protection is exercise and heart attacks. If you were exposed to exercise, you're less likely to have a heart attack. That's called a protective effect. Colon cancer. If you have a high fiber diet, you're less likely to develop colon cancer. That high fiber diet is considered a protective effect, right? Where you would get odds ratio or relative risk that are less than 1. You're likely to, anyway. Those are two examples. As opposed to many things that will increase our risk, which is more typical, but things like, a fatty diet and heart disease, that's likely to increase your risk. Sedentary life and heart disease, et cetera, et cetera.
So are we making, with odds ratio and relative risk, are we making conclusion without considering other confounding variables too? Is that how you are?
At this simple level, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, at this simple level. However, that it's rare. You rarely actually do it this way. You, like I said, you use either logistic regression or Cox regression
okay.
for these two types of studies.
Okay.
Or proportional hazards, it's sometimes called two for a cohort. Okay. But then, nevertheless. But this one, no, you're not looking at confounders.
Okay.
Now, why is the odds ratio considered an estimate? Okay. So, for a cohort study, we have exposed, not exposed, we have cases, and we have controls. A, B, C, D. And the relative risk, and here we have the marginal total A plus B and the marginal total C plus D. And the relative risk is equal to A over A plus B and C over C plus D. Yes. That's called the ratio of the incidences also, because this is the incidence of the condition, whatever it is, among everyone who's exposed. And this is the incidence of the condition among everyone who's not exposed. So what we're looking for is the ratio. If this incidence is much higher than this, then we have an elevated relative risk. Okay? This is considered a better form. Now for case control, with the same 2x2 table, and we're still at the marginal totals, but the assumption that we make is that since this is a case control samples are usually smaller, the assumption that we're making is that the control, the exposures without that don't get the condition are about equivalent to the total. Right? And we're making the assumption that the controls that are not exposed are about equivalent to that marginal total. So, if we make that equivalence and we look at our relative risk equation, and we say A plus B is the same as B, and C plus D is the same as D, and you do the cross multiplication, it becomes AD over CB.
Interesting.
And that's how they derive it. It's assuming a certain congruence between these two sets.
Yeah.
That's why it's considered an approximation. Right? Whereas this is an actual population. This is a subset, or a large enough sample from a population that we can assume that it's the entire population. This is a subset of it, and it's a smaller sample, and therefore it's considered valid to make that assumption, and the equation breaks or reduces to AD over BC or CB, however you want to look at it.
So considering it's a small sample, you can make an estimate.
That's right.
So a bit bigger than looking at
if you've done a specific cohort study, if you followed the rules for case control and cohort,
yeah.
Then you can do this. Yes.
So what number of sample and what sample size are you looking at? About 30 or?
Usually, you don't really look at the sample size as much as what your constraints are for data collection. Does this make sense to everybody?
Yeah.
All right. So here we have a hypothetical example where we have an assembly task and whether they develop a highly repetitive assembly task, and then whether the individuals develop a Patel syndrome. And I ginned up the data so that that was true, that general congruence there. And down here, I had a couple respiratory disease and exposure to silica dust. Okay. What larger population? This is our odds ratio. This is our relative risk for these two. Okay. It's just to demonstrate the mechanics of it. There's nothing. It's just arithmetic. There's nothing profound about the mechanics. This implies that we have 2.1 times the likelihood of developing carpal tunnel syndrome if we're exposed to the highly repetitive assembly task. This implies that we are 2.4 to 2.5 times as likely to develop upper respiratory disease if we're exposed to silica dust. We don't know whether that's significant or not. And you probably see this coming. You can do a confidence interval and a chi-squared test on them to determine whether or not it's a significantly elevated risk. This is verbally what I talked about here. Okay? Odds ratio, you can't calculate incidence with a case control study because we don't have the whole population. And it's valid because it's only valid when the cases are relatively new. We don't want to have old cases in our study, and we have to select our cases and controls and without any reference, only after the fact determining their exposure status. Those are requirements for case control. Okay, the chi-squared tests for both of them are identical. Okay. Assuming that we have correctly chosen a case control or cohort analysis, and that we've chosen determined exposures appropriately, to have appropriate case definitions, we followed all the rules, the actual calculation of the chi-squared is the same. This looks like it's a big equation to remember, but it's not. All it is row total, column total, gram total for every one of the cells. Row total, column total, gram total. Row total, column total, gram total. And the same for all four of the cells. And once you've calculated each one of those row total, column total divided by gram total, you sum them, and you can calculate your, and that gives you your expected cell values. Okay? So this row total, column total, times column total over gram total is the expected cell value. So our observed is what the data we collect, expected is what we calculate, and you calculate your chi-squared by summing, in this case, 4, observed minus expected times the square root over expected. That should look fairly familiar right now. Because we did observe minus expected or squared over expected with just 1 for the SMR. Here we have 4 components to the chi-squared. So this is the example from our CTS example. This is our observed. This is expected. And 43.6 is row total, 1104 times column total, 77, divided by grand total, 1950. That's 43.6. And just choose another one at random. This one here, 800, unexposed controls is 846 times 1873 divided by 1950 is 812.6. So this is what you would expect if it were evenly distributed, okay, if there were no difference. So this is the component, observed minus expected over expected. So observed minus expected, quantity squared divided by expected is 3.5. Do that for all 4 cells, add those 4 together, that's our chi-squared statistic. chi-squared statistic then compare, once again, it depends on whether you're doing one-sided or two-sided, we'll assume one-sided, so you use 3.84, your criterion value. And this is the same thing for the silica dust. And this is just to give you more data to work with for determining it. That's even bigger, 125.4 for the chi-squared. Yeah, sorry.
Are we ever going to change our degrees of freedom?
No.
Okay.
That will always be one for this. Reason being, for any contingency table, these are always 2x2s. It's number of rows minus one, number of columns times the number of columns minus one. So it's 2 minus 1 times 2 minus 1, which is 1. So it's always that. So this is the same calculation for the silica dust exposure. And so comparing them both to 3.84, we can see that they're both significantly elevated. Now, let's calculate our 95% confidence intervals on the odds ratio and relative risk. Let me remind you what this notation is, EXP. EXP is a way so that I don't have to use the equation anymore. EXPX is the same thing as e to the x. It's Euler's number. So, this is e to the plus z1 minus alpha over 2, which is usually 1.96, times the standard error, which is this. And this is and for the upper limit, and minus that for the lower limit. Right? So you do the calculation twice, once with a positive exponent to the Euler's number, and once with a negative exponent to Euler's number. Yeah, so that.
So our EXP in this case be the, let's say, from the last one, 8.5, or the previous number we got for chi square, or is the EXP for each individual box of our exposure values?
No, it's Euler's number, it's E. It's on your calculator.
Okay, great. No, okay, I see.
It's an actual like.
It's E to the X.
Okay.
Got confusing.
Now, these are basically the same formulas except for the odds ratio. You use the OR, you multiply the odds ratio times the result, and for the relative risk, you use the relative risk times the result. And I'll go through these calculations, okay? But let's look at the formulas a bit first. The standard errors are different too. Standard error for the odds ratio is pretty easy to remember. It's the square root of 1 over a plus 1 over b plus 1 over c plus 1 over d. It's pretty easy to remember. With the cohort, it's a little less obvious. It's 1 over a minus 1 over a plus b plus 1 over c minus 1 over c plus d. And also remember, this is in the equation sheet. I'm not expecting you to remember this, but sometimes it's just helpful to remember patterns because then you know if you look around the equation sheet. Okay, so let's look at a calculation. Can I erase this? Okay, so let's look at the odds ratio or the odds ratio confidence interval for the carpal tunnel syndrome example. So that number was 2.1. So for the upper limit, that's 2.1 times e to the positive 1.96, and this is the standard error, that's 0.26. What was it? Right, 0.26. And for the lower limit, 2.1 times e to the negative 1.96 times 0.26. So this you get 1.26 to 0.49. That's consistent with the significant chi-squared results because it doesn't include 1, all right? Does everybody, I find that the biggest source of confusion here is the notation of what to do with the plus or minus in the exp. Does everybody understand that?
Yeah.
And how to apply that? Because once you understand that, the rest of it's just arithmetic, really, and using your calculator. So, both of these were significantly elevated, and you can see that this confidence interval does not include 1, this confidence interval does not include 1. So these are consistent with the results. All right, so far so good?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Incidence. Let's just talk a bit about incidence. Incidence among the exposed, incidence among the unexposed. That's I sub e, and that's a over a plus b. In other words, the number of cases amongst all of the exposed. And the incidence among the unexposed, I sub u, is the number of cases amongst all the unexposed. So another way to express the relative risk is I sub e over I sub u, which you might see sometimes, because each of those are incident rates. There's another measurement called incidence density. When you have the number of cases and the person time that it was exposed. And this is actually pretty more common because you're more likely to have person time of exposure, person time of the unexposed than you are in the number of people. So this is person time in the denominator. That's, and when you have person time, that's incidence density. And you can still do these calculations. It's just a little bit different. So incidence density is person time in the denominators. And hold on a second, I'll check ahead here. Yeah. I talk a little bit more about incidence density and calculations for it in the next topic. So, but I needed to define that for. Talk about some of the other measurements that we use in cohort studies. The first one, if you're used to it, now remember, these are cohorts. For a case control study, you can't do most of this, or you can only estimate most of this. So, attributable risk is one of the measures that we are interested in looking at in cohort studies. And first, let's look at the calculation of it. We have the incidence among the exposed, and we subtract off the incidence among the unexposed. What they're assuming there is that the incidence among the unexposed is sort of noise in the population. He wasn't exposed to anything, but he still developed carpal tunnel syndrome or upper respiratory disease or something like that. But he wasn't exposed to in the case of the carpal tunnel syndrome, wasn't exposed to the highly repetitive job. In the case of the upper respiratory disease, wasn't exposed to the silica dust. But they still developed the condition. So that means that there's a steady state in the population. Right? What the attributable risk is the excess incidence that you're exposed to, the excess incidence that results from exposure to a risk factor. Right. So if it's zero, it means it's the same. The exposure is the same as the steady state, and there is no excess risk. If it's greater than zero, that means you have an excess. If it's less than zero, you have a protective effect. So if we eliminate the exposure, the attributable risk is what would be remaining. And if we got rid of it, so if we got rid of that exposure, that's how much you could get rid of in the population. So that's attributable risk. Now, you can convert that to a percentage. It's not very interesting, I don't think, but converting it to a percentage gives you the percent that can be eliminated. By eliminating exposure. Both of these are measures of what would happen if you got rid of the exposure. There's another measure called population attributable risk. And this is a slight distinction in that here we look at all of the cases in the entire population and subtract off the incidence among the unexposed. If the exposure were eliminated, that's how many of the entire population would be eliminated. Now, that's not the excess exposure due to of the incidence of the exposed. It's the excess exposure in the entire population, a slightly different measure. I'll have some examples of these. So let's just, and then once again, you can also calculate a percentage of it. So let's take a look at an example. This is from British Medical Journal, 1976, where they looked at some at attributable risk. What they were interested in is death rates for male British physicians due to lung cancer and coronary heart disease. Right. What they had is death rates from lung cancer among smokers and non-smokers. And coronary heart disease among smokers and non-smokers per 100,000. So those rates are adjusted per 100,000 male physicians, okay, in Britain. At first glance, it looks like, you know, the smokers were at much greater risk for lung cancer and also somewhat greater risk for coronary heart disease. I'm just looking at the raw data. Now let's look at the relative risk, because you can take the lung cancer relative risk, because remember that's the incidence among the exposed and the incidence among the unexposed. And we have those data, incidence among the exposed per 100,000, incidence among the unexposed per 100,000. So that means that the relative risk for lung cancer, if you smoke, is 14. 14 times more likely to develop lung cancer if you smoke than if you don't. The attributable risk, on the other hand, is the incidence among the exposed 140 minus the incidence among the unexposed 10. So that means 130 out of 100,000, if we eliminated smoking, could be eliminated. 130 cases, yeah.
Oh, okay.
I think
it says
we
got
10,000,
but I see it's
top. Yeah, it's per 100,000. Yeah. Okay. Now let's look at coronary heart disease. It doesn't look nearly as bad because the relative risk is 1.6 versus 14. But the attributable risk is subtracting those off. If we eliminated smoking, we actually, per 100,000, save more people in an absolute sense from developing the disease if we eliminated exposure to smoking. So the impact of smoking on coronary heart disease, even though the risk is not nearly as high, is much greater than the impact of eliminating smoking with regard to lung cancer. This is the way that you use attributable risk, because it tells you in absolute numbers the number of cases or the proportion of cases that could be eliminated if you took away the exposure. In this case, it happens to be smoking. Now, the attributable risk percent is a little bit different. Here, it looks like it flip-flops, because we're looking at percentages. The percentage, attributable risk percent for lung cancer, we could eliminate a much higher percentage of it, even though the absolute number is higher than the coronary heart disease. But you have to understand the limitations of both of these. As a percentage, we get rid of a lot more of the cases, 130 out of per 100,000, whereas only whatever the difference is between 669 and 413, that's the
256.
Yes, the 256 we developed, we'd eliminate, but that's only 38% of the cases. So the attributable risk percent, attributable risk, and relative risk are all interpreted somewhat differently, and kind of like the age-specific rates, the crude and the age-adjusted rates, or category-adjusted rates, they're used for different things. Right? Here, this gives us a percentage, whereas if we went into the absolute number, we look at the attributable risk only. This is only something that you can do with cohort studies. Questions so far? Okay. This is a hypothetical case that I pulled from one of the textbooks. I think it was Paggiano, where fish consumption and stroke risk. Okay, as a low fat source of protein is the idea behind this. Okay, so the exposure here, and this is a little bit backward, but the exposure is that you don't have it, okay, that you don't eat fish. So I'm exposed to not eating fish. So it's kind of backwards, but I did that on purpose because I want to show you the an easier way to interpret it later, an easier way to lay it out. But yes, I don't eat fish, and no, I do eat fish. This is kind of the way to interpret this. Okay. But like I said, this purpose of that. This is significantly elevated. Okay, relative risk, this is the limits. Now, the incidence among the exposed, and this isn't standardized, so this is a proportion, 0.05. Among the unexposed, 0.02, because what that is 23 out of 802 versus 82 out of 1,631. And the incidence among in the population is 105 out of 2,433. So that's the incidence in population, incidence among the exposed, incidence unexposed, incidence among the exposed. Attributable risk is 206, let's say, just leave it at 2. I'll keep it at 2 significant digits, is 2 per 100, okay, 2% of that. Percentage reduction, if we made everybody have fish in their diet, is 43%. For the entire population, if we had everyone put fish into their diet, subtract the exposed from the population, subtract the unexposed, we only would eliminate one. And at the population level, 33.5%. Now this is kind of, like I said, it's a little bit backwards. So let's look at this in a more straightforward way. Here is whether you have fish in your diet or not. Okay, this is the inversion of the other table. The exposure is having that dietary portion, and the non-exposure is not having the dietary portion. So the 82 and 1,549 was the exposure in the other one. And the 23 out of 779 was the non-exposure in the previous example. But it's the same study. Exactly the same study, you've just arranged your data differently. Now we have a protective effect, 0.57, and it's significant. Right? Because if you have fish in your diet, you have a reduced risk of stroke. And that's a protective effect. So now the unexposed ones are the ones that have a higher risk, and the exposed have a lower risk, and the population somewhere in between. So So let's look at the attributable risk is now negative. So if I took fish out of everybody's diet, if they lacked that, that would increase, because that's negative, that would increase 2 in 100 cases of stroke. And it would increase the percentage by 75. If I took it out of the diet, it would be less than the, at the population level, it would increase almost 1. So it's a similar result, similar interpretation, but you have to interpret negative numbers now. And this is a, and this is an increase in the rate of strokes by 16% population level. I'll give you a minute to digest that, pun not intended. Is the idea of reducing incidence by changing the exposure or taking away the exposure, does that make sense? And this is just a quantification of that.
It looks like one of the same, because if you're removing exposure, then you're reducing the incidence, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what it is.
Yeah. And if the exposure is something good, like in this example, that it's an increase in negative number.
Yeah.
Does everybody else feel comfortable with that? As you can imagine, we'll have an opportunity to do this on our own next week. All right. With case control, the only thing you can estimate is attributable risk percent, which is really a duplicate of the odds ratio. It doesn't really help you that much, because the attributable risk percent is a similar interpretation as the odds ratio. As the odds ratio goes up, the attributable risk percent goes up, because they're positively proportional to each other. But that's the way you would calculate. You take the odds ratio, subtract 1 from it, assuming that that's the steady state, and divided by the odds ratio and multiplied by 100. For CTS, this would be 67%. Can't calculate any of those other values there. And that means that if you eliminated the exposure, mining in this case of lung cancer, that you would eliminate 67% of the cases. Very straightforward to attributable risk percent interpretation. All right, let me continue. I have a couple of things that I sort of tacked on to the end here that I thought would be of interest, because most of these cases, most of these analyses are for case-only studies. What are you going to get most of the time when you're working somewhere? Are most employers interested in recording cases, in recording non-cases? Let's put it that way. Most of them, like I said, Ford was unique in that regard. They recorded everybody. How long they worked there, what conditions they were working under, what they contracted, so you could easily sort out cases and non-cases. But most employers are interested in meeting OSHA requirements and recording recordables, or something that is, an injury that wasn't recordable or something like that, but something happened. In every case, most employers aren't interested in recording something that didn't happen. So these are some approaches to analyzing these data with case-only data, which is what you will probably encounter more likely. Okay. You guys remember the binomial distribution? Did you guys... Let's see. You remember binomial, I know. Nobody else had QM with me, did they?
No. Do I remember it? I probably will after you explain it again.
What's that?
I said, do I remember it? I probably will after you explain it.
Okay.
Is that related to Pascal's triangle?
No.
Okay.
No, I don't think so.
I have no idea.
Because I don't know Pascal's triangle, so, but that doesn't sound And that doesn't sound like it would be pertinent. Tell me if it is, actually.
Okay.
Since I don't know what Pascal's triangle is, I probably shouldn't say no, but I don't. It doesn't sound like it is.
Okay.
So, binomial distribution is, let's take a human factors example. Binomial distribution is you can either a person will have an error as a result of doing something, or they will do it correctly, a non-error. There's only two possible outcomes. Flipping a coin, two possible outcomes. Anything where there is only two possible outcomes is binomially distributed. Now, it's a special case of what's called a multinomial distribution. That's the general. The multinomial distribution is a general where you can have n outcomes. The binomial is the special case of multinomial where there's only two outcomes. Okay. In this case, we are interested in the binomial outcome because there's cases and non-cases. There's only two possibilities. And so binomial is very common. And a binomial, a particular probability of x equal to any value, x, is follows the distribution of this, and I'll explain this. Where you have n objects. For instance, let's talk about, you go out in the morning, start your car. For the next 20 times I start my car, so that would be n, 20 attempts. Okay. I want to know what the probability is that it will always start. So x is x events. I'd probably say x events is zero because that's zero non-starts. So what's the probability of start? The probability of start, let's say I keep data on this for some reason. Probability of start is, over the past year, I've been really obsessive compulsive about recording every time I record this. The probability of start is, my car is in pretty good shape, but it's getting a little bit old. It is 0.9. 9 times out of 10 it starts. It's getting a little old, you know, has some problems. So that means the probability of not start is 0.1. Because there's only two outcomes, they have to be complementary, and they have to add up to one. And that's one of the rules, is your event space, everything in it has to add up to one, the probability of all the possible events. Okay. So, if I use this, and non-starts are my event of interest, then that says I have 20, 0, and I'll explain this in a minute. Does anybody know what that is, other than Kurt? That's a combination, and you have to expand that out. I'm sorry?
I said at one point in my life I did, like in high school.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Okay.
Anyway,
so the probability of interest is non-start, so it would be 0.1 to the 0, and 1 minus 0.1 to the n, which is 20, minus x, which is 0. This is a combination. So 20 objects taken 0 at a time expands to 20 factorial over 20 minus 0 factorial, 0 factorial. That's what that expands.
That's
a combination. And by definition, probably doesn't make any sense, but by definition, 0 factorial is 1. Well, it doesn't take long to tell you to see what that's going to come out to, 20 factorial over 20 factorial. 1. So that reduces to 1. That's why I'm doing this the easy way. So you should do something to do this in your head.
Are you sure that's 1 polynomial? I see what you did.
Yep.
Thank you.
You guys are never going to forget that, are you? It's a joke from ergonomics, forget it. These guys are obsessed with it. So that means that, don't worry about it. This goes to one, right? What's anything raised to the zeroth power?
One.
That goes to one. And so what this reduces to is 0.9 to the 20th. Somebody tell me what that is.
Point one two.
Okay, so even if your car is in pretty good shape, starts 9 times out of 10, and the next 20 starts, you only have 12% chance that it's going to start every last time. That's what the binomial distribution tells you, that type of thing. And if we apply it to cases and non-cases, we can say that our observed proportion is we have a number of cases over the number of people. That you can get pretty easily, right? And B then is the number of non-cases, okay? So I subtract the number of people exposed and the number of 9 cases, and I have some reference population. And you can usually get data on the prevalence of carpal tunnel syndrome or some condition like that. So this is our, so we have an observed proportion, which is P hat, and we have a reference population, which is P. So we take that, and we try to find out what the lower and the upper bounds of the confidence interval are. Now notice the reason that this allows us the lower and the upper bounds is we have a plus or a minus in there. The plus for the upper, minus for the lower. And then taking that proportion, you can find the lower and the upper relative risk. Using our lower bound over the population proportion and our upper bound over the population proportion. Look at an example where we have 6 cases and our population of, in a plant, say, 1,694 people. So our P hat then reduces to that, and we know that our condition, carpal tunnel, has a prevalence like this, 0.0012. Okay. Somewhat arbitrary. So that's a proportion and our reference proportion. The only rub with this is that you need a reference proportion. So in this case, our lower and upper limit, our p hat 0.0035, or 1.96 for Z1 minus alpha over 2, and A and B, which is 6 and 1,688. So this is our proportion, lower and upper limit, right, for significant digits. To get the relative risk, we do the lower limit over our population proportion, our population prevalence, I'm sorry, and the upper limit for our population prevalence. So now we can't test for significance, but we can develop a relative risk range. It's pretty broad, but it looks like it doesn't include one, so it's probably significantly elevated. Since we used Z01 minus alpha over 2 in our calculations, this implies at alpha of 0.05 that there's a significantly elevated risk. And all we had was the number of cases and our total population and a reference proportion. Make sense? Okay. Oh, this have anything to do with Pascal's triangle?
Yeah.
I don't think so, but I didn't, like I said, I don't know exactly what it is. I'm going to look it up now because I don't know. Another one, case-only approach, is based on another distribution called the Poisson distribution. I'm going into too much agonizing detail about Poisson, but the Poisson distribution is what governs people arriving online, for instance. As everybody is familiar with Poisson distribution, where everyone will show up and the line will grow, and then it'll shrink to almost nothing, because no one shows up, and then everybody shows up and the line grows, when it shrinks back down. The inter-arrival times are exponential. That's called the Poisson process. Right? Poisson process is when you're recording occurrences over a period of time. So here, we have number of cases, and we have measurement of exposure, where we have stratum-specific rates, and you have the time exposure, and then the total time of exposure. Okay? So just keep that in mind for a minute. Here, you have a confidence interval on the incidence rates, where you have your E, the number of cases, and the Z value. The only, and this is a different E than this is. Unfortunately, that's probably not the best notation. I just realized that.
Is that the Euler's number again?
This is Euler's number again. This is exposure. Okay. You might want to put a capital E there. I think I might do that when I change this. Example. Right. We have 41 cases and 28,010 person years of exposure. Right. It doesn't matter how many people, but of all the people that you have 28,010 years. You can take all the people and add it up. Is everybody comfortable with the idea of person time? Sometimes I've had some confusion over what that means. I'm going to assume that. Let's say that we have three people. Person one, two, three. And this person has worked 10 years, this person has worked 15, this person has worked 20. Okay? Amongst all of them, that's 45 person years. Right? Because you add that up, you get 45 person years of exposure. It's simply a sum of all the years that all the people have been working. Okay, make sense? And that's what we're talking about here. So person years, 28,010 person years might sound like a lot, but it could be a lot of people only working for a few years apiece. That's a summary number. And we have an expected prevalence, 23.3. The expected prevalence, I didn't talk about it. The expected prevalence here is, this is a different example. Sorry, I thought I'd put this in. But here we're making an assumption about expected prevalence, 23.3, and we get an incidence rate that is significant, looks like it's significantly above one. Now, let's take a more larger example. This is age groups from 20 to 64 among our 1952 farmer census. Number of years in each age group, so that adds up to 45 years. Number of farmers is this, so that means person time, 5 years for this number of farmers is that. So that means that our capital T is the total of all the person time. We have standard deaths, and then we calculate expected deaths, and this is from a previous example, but our expected deaths is this, 2084. And that is an example of E, the expected expectation of deaths. And this is A, the actual observed ones. Okay, so we have cases, total exposure, and expected. And that's all we're calculating here for this case. And then I have type error and critical value, and standard error, and the incidence rate. Standard error comes from, the standard error comes from 1 over the square root of a. This is the standard error portion of it. So in this case, it's 1 over the square root of 1,464. And our incidence rate that we calculate using this formula is 0.7. And then using the confidence interval incidence rate, get a range, and our range is 0.74, 0.67 for the lower. Now, let me look at something here for a moment, because I think that there's a portion in there that's not as clear as it could be. Okay, this is the incidence rate. The standard incidence rate is number of cases over the number expected. That's where we get the 0.7.
Put out the link function, right?
I'm sorry? The natural log? Yes, yeah, the natural log. So the incidence rate is 1,464 over 2,084. Then that A over E, when you substitute that back into this equation, this being the incidence rate, and this being the standard error, and raise that to the exponent, once plus, once minus, you get a range. So, our range is 0.67, 0.74, which, just like with the SMRs, and this is closely related to SMRs, and just like with the SMRs, we can see that this is significantly reduced death rate, because we would expect a lot more. This Poisson approach is a little bit more complex than the binomial approach. I think the binomial approach is easier to apply under most cases than the Poisson approach is. And here, like I said, it's the same as those for the SMR. All right. Two questions. First of all, any questions on the lecture? We're going to start out next week talking about the homework set to this lecture. But before I send you off to do that, do you have any questions about it? Yes, about.
I'm wondering if you just go over the combination formula you wrote on the board there just one more time. I'm still a bit.
Sure.
You might just beat them. It's hard for me to see from over here.
Yeah, well, let me write it here. In the generalized form, n objects take an x of time as n factorial n minus x factorial x factorial.
Okay,
and just apply that the whole time.
That's what you wanted, basically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just with actual numbers in for n and x. That's all. And then I have another question for you guys. Sorry. You may have noticed that I actually, Prince, I need you to listen to this part.
Okay.
Just briefly, I'll be short. You may have noticed that I had another topic scheduled for the day on air. We're not going to do it in half an hour, because that's way too overloaded. And I was looking at the schedule, and the schedule's a little compressed, the way I had originally planned it. So I have a proposed change that I'd like to have you look at. And I can post this on Canvas, but I wanted to present it to you first. So today we do the case control studies. Next week we'd start on the error, which is actually a fairly small topic, and begin on analytical methods. Following week, finish analytical methods, review session on the 25th, which would push the exam ahead to the 1st. The problem with that, that I see, is that 5 out of 8 of you are in ergonomics, and that's the day before the ergonomics exam, again. So I would like you to think about that. If I try to cram in error and analytical methods next week, it's going to be very, very full. I can just tell you that right now. It's going to be very crammed, and I would rather you get that than not. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this part of it, ignore the rest of the stuff, this is just for me. I'm going to take this part of it and put it up on Canvas and let you think about it. What would happen after that then is we'd have a day for logistic, a day for infectious. As it turns out now, it looks like we're not going to have class on the 22nd because I'm finally going to have my back surgery on the 21st, so I don't think I'll be in here. I don't think I'm going to be in here talking to you guys on the 22nd. That's the week of Thanksgiving anyway. We'll have a review session, and then maybe the exam. I'm going to arrange this, either have the exam here and project due during finals, or vice versa. I'm not too sure yet, but one or the other. But I think that this is a less compressed schedule, okay? And I'd like you guys to look at it, yeah.
I was gonna ask about presentations.
Presentations, there's 8 of you. If you have 10-minute presentations, we can do that in one session.
Okay. Couldn't we do topic 5 next week, and if we don't finish it, have it roll over to the week after, and then?
In other words, see what happens next week?
Yeah.
I'm perfectly fine with that. That's reasonable. So if we don't finish topic 5 next week, we'll probably have to go to this.
Or add our topic 4 with our review session.
Actually, it has to precede 5. That's why it's in the order that it is. Yeah. So I just wanted to present this to you guys so you can be thinking about it. I'll post it. But I think Kara's idea is good, just to see what happens next week, although I'm virtually certain that by this time next week your minds will be numb and we won't be finished with 5. 5 is a difficult topic.
Since 4 is kind of like you said, is very small, you can just kind of like skim through it to see what is the most important part of it you want us to take home with, and that should be it. If it's important to cover the whole material, then there's nothing we can do about that, though.
Unfortunately, it's important to, it's only 20-some slides.
Okay.
It's not real difficult material, but it's important to the understanding of analytical methods, so we can't really gloss over it.
Okay, then it is what it is then.
That's kind of what I'm just warning you guys.
Okay.
So, like I said, I'll post this on Canvas in the next couple of days so you can look more closely at it. And then we'll see what happens next week.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
And be thinking about it, and I'll see you next week.